A Winnipeg corner store owner has been charged with killing a shoplifter over what the victim's friend said was a can of luncheon meat.
Police say 62-year-old Kwang Soo Kim has been charged with manslaughter in the death of 29-year-old Geraldine Beardy. Beardy was beaten as she fled a family-owned store in the city's north end last fall. She died 5 days later in hospital. Kim was originally accused of aggravated assault, but last week, police laid a manslaughter charge after consulting Crown attorneys.
Joining us now in studio, defense attorney Jeffrey Manishen, who also has extensive experience as a Crown attorney. Jeff, what's the rule on how much force one can use when defending one's property? Or for that matter, how much force can you use when you're defending yourself or your family?
Well, we'll start with the property issue, Mark. The criminal code does provide a defense if you're in peaceable possession of personal property to be able to use a degree of force to be able to get it back from somebody if they take it from you, and especially if they resist. But the way the code reads, you aren't allowed to strike them and you aren't allowed to cause bodily harm to them. But if they continue to resist, then they're deemed in law to have assaulted you, and you are therefore entitled to use a measure of force to be able to get the property back. The difficulty is, if you use more force than is reasonably necessary, you are criminally liable for excessive force. So that's the difficulty in a case like this one. If you have somebody who takes property from a store and presumably unarmed, can you use a measure of force to be able to get it back? Sure you can. But get to the point of using lethal force, force that could cause serious personal injury, there's a real difficulty there that the force could be considered excessive.
Does that change if you're defending yourself or your child?
You have a greater capacity if you're defending yourself, and particularly if you have a basis to believe, if you honestly and reasonably believe that you're in danger of death or serious harm yourself, then you can, under the criminal code, have some room to be able to defend yourself. And if it's in circumstances where you did whatever you could do to try and avoid having to get into that kind of conflict, the level of force you can use is going to be considered much more justifiable. But generally, we have that kind of catch-all that we look at. You are criminally liable for excessive force. You aren't supposed to measure with precision or nicety exactly how much force is needed. The law isn't that strict. But I guess you'd probably say, look, let's measure a degree of proportionality. What's the force you fear? What's your basis for believing that you were in that kind of difficulty? And what's the force that you used? If they're roughly proportionate, you're going to be okay.
Okay, so there was a case in Toronto, I think about a year ago, where a shop owner found someone who had stolen from him, tried to hold that person until the police arrived, and found out the hard way that you just can't do that. You can't just grab somebody and forcibly confine them until the police arrives. And the guy got off scot-free, and the shop owner was the one who got in trouble.
Yeah, what I read about that one, and I think there may still be some charges before the court on that, Mark, they had a series of charges, including some that were considered more serious, where the shopkeeper could have had a jury trial. As I recall it, the Crown decided not to proceed with those, but proceed with less serious charges, I think forcible confinement or something in that kind of nature. And that's a difficult one. I know when I read that in the paper, I thought, did the citizen have the power to be able to make an arrest for someone they found committing a criminal offense such as stealing property? They can. I think probably the question became, what extent did they do to be able to confine? How long did they hold the person for? We'll have to see how the courts decide that one, because that's one that seems to have closer competing issues.
If you own a gun, this is Canada, if you own a gun and you use it either to frighten away an intruder or perhaps even shoot it at a person, would you again be charged for discharging a firearm?
You could. There was a case that happened in Hamilton a few years ago where a fellow saw some young people stealing from his neighbor's garage, or at least behaving in circumstances where he believed that the people were young guys were stealing. And the young guys took off down the street, and the neighbor fired a rifle in their direction. Now, his evidence was he fired it at the ground, but it was close enough to them. The pellets went off the ground and went up and hit them. And there was a trial, and the judge found that he basically discharged the firearm in a careless manner. Mm-hmm. It would be pretty tough to be able to say he felt he needed to use some force to be able to protect himself or his neighbor if the young guys were running away. So the difficulty always, when you're into the use of lethal force and you're going to be using it, there better be some evidence that you had real reason to believe that you were in serious danger yourself.
Is this different? I mean, we always see the Hollywood version of these things. Is this different in the States?
Well, I think in the States they seem to, number one, they seem to have more circumstances in which people can have firearms, including having them by way of permit or otherwise, having them at home or elsewhere. And their cases seem to go before juries, and I think they have a higher level of tolerance for the use of firearms by way of force. In Canada, because we don't have as many people with firearms, we don't see as many instances in which they're used. There was a case years ago when I was with the Crown's office where he had a guy who'd seen someone he believed to be breaking into his home. He went up and he was upstairs in his home and he had a rifle and he yelled at the guy, "Stop, get away or I'll shoot." And the guy kept coming and he then fired a warning shot in the air and said, get away or I'll shoot." The fellow kept coming and the homeowner did shoot him and kill him. And we had to consider in the Crown's office, do we want to proceed with the charge or not? We felt, what more could the guy do?
Yeah.
So he wasn't charged.
No charges. Jeff, it seems to me that anyone who's watching this program now and is considering robbing a place goes, you know what? What's the worst that can happen to me? In this particular regard, it seems as if the victim is the one who is being victimized, and the perpetrator seems, in a lot of cases, to have more rights. Would that be a fair assessment?
I think the way that you have to assess it, Mark, is a matter of, again, proportionality. So if you have somebody who's stealing a can of food, does that render them susceptible to being killed? I think that's extreme.
Absolutely.
On the robbery aspect, though, and again, a case on that one called Scopoletti happened up north, I think, in the Barrie area. A couple of young guys were actually robbing the store, whether with weapons or with violence. And the shopkeeper wound up killing both of them. Evidence was admitted at that trial not only to show that he was aware they had some history of robberies, but that they did other robberies in the past that he didn't even know about. It was relevant evidence to show that he had every reason to be afraid of them. They acted the way he said. He was acquitted. So it's not something we would encourage a robber to feel. You have a license to be able to go in and steal. There won't be any consequences. On the other hand, we want to be able to say to shopkeepers, you heard the colloquialism, you can't take the law into your own hands. That's meant to deal with situations where what you're doing is really meant to cause significant harm, far more severe than the harm that you're trying to prevent.
Did you say he shot them?
Pardon me?
Did you say he shot
In the case up north, yeah.
And what kind of gun? Because you can't have a handgun in Canada.
I don't know what he had there, whether he had a permit, what his circumstances were, whether he had a rifle. But ultimately, the key to the story, though, Donna, was that he was found not guilty. And part of the key that was a development in the law was evidence of these young guys' pattern of doing robberies in the past, even some robberies he didn't even know about, hadn't heard about, was considered admissible because it tended to show that what he said was the truth. They really were out to rob him.
Okay. That's defense attorney Jeffrey Manishen. Jeff, always a pleasure. Thanks so much for your legal expertise.
My pleasure, Mark.
Thanks, Jeff.
Thanks, Donna.